Hello, students. I just realized that I have the lecture before. I was speaking with a mouth mask. Why, I don't know. But okay, now I have put it away. And let's see. I told you that I would start with some example. Now, let me do the following example. We have some a vector field. That vector field is x, y, z. And we have a surface. And that surface, that is a solid cylinder. And there is there are also given some expressions. That is that the x plus x squared plus y squared is less or equal a squared, and the z coordinate is greater or equal minus h and less or equal h. So here you have your cylinder. Now, most of the time, and I should say to you, try to make some sketch of those things, that then you have also an idea what you have to do. So first of all, the sketch of the solid cylinder. Now we have here our R3 with our good orientation. If I take the cross product of the x axis with the y axis, I get in the z direction. That goes well, so my orientation is good. Then I can make a picture of that solid cylinder. I see that in the xy plane you have a circle with radius a, and I will do it with some other color. So here minus a minus a, and I see that my z term is less or equal minus h and greater or equal h. So I have here my h, and I have here my minus h, and so you can go up that circle. You can translate it a little bit around the z-axis to upside, and you can go down, and you have your cylinder. And sorry, this will I did those things I can make. Yeah, here you have your cylinder. And then you have to calculate the flux through the surface of that cylinder. Flux through the surface of cylinder. And maybe I can also put a solid cylinder. That is the question. Now, then I look to the orientations. If I add the upper part, when the z is h, this one here, I have to go in the same direction at the z-axis, so that goes upwards. But if I am then at the lower part, I have to go downwards to have the same orientation on the wall cylinder. And here at the wall of the cylinder, if that part should come, if we should look to that cylinder here as the front, then the normal would be come to us. And now I have here just put the normal, but let me use the unit normal. Yes, because if we have to calculate the flux, we also need unit normals. So here you have your, that are your orientation. So the wall surface is orientable, no problem. And we know how the normals are. And now we can calculate, we have to calculate three integrals. And then those integrals we have to add together, and that gives us the flux. adding together, and that gives us the flux. Okay. Now, maybe we can also give some numbers. The top, let me call that one. The lower part, I think, 2, because I think the 1 and 2, I don't know if there will be much difference in what comes out of it. And then the side wall, that will be led to 3. I just look. The first one, I see that the unit normal is the same as the z-axis, so I have 0, 0, 1, no problem. The second one, so below, there you have for your unit normal not 0, 0, 1, but 0, 0, minus 1. Yeah, be careful with your orientation here. And with the third one, the wall of the cylinder, I think that you can see, not with any, not so much problems, that you have, if you are in the origin and you go to the wall, then you see that you get for your normal nothing else than the direction of the normal will be x, y, 0, a vector that which stays perpendicular to the circle x squared plus y squared is a squared, but this has not the length 1. You have to divide by its length, so I think you have to divide by a. So you have here the unit normal of the wall. So 1 is of the top, and that other one is from below, and the third one that is of the wall of the cylinder. Now let's see the integral, the flux of the first part. Now you have your vector field x, y, z. And I directly see that my z is there equal to h. So I can fill in here just some h. No problem. And then I have to take the inner product with the unit normal. So 0, 0, 1. And that I have to integrate over the surface. Now, and here I see that I have... it goes not really easy, because I see that my inner product becomes just some constant, and there I have to integrate over S, and that S, that is the circle x squared plus y squared less or equal a squared, and the z is equal to h. Now, in a circle, and here you see some constant over that circle, you have just the area, and the area of a circle, that is easily done, area circle pi r squared, and the radius is a, so we have a squared. And so we get out of the top, really easy, h times pi times h squared. Now, that is the top. Then we go down. Let me go to the lower part. And so the flux of the second part. Now we have x, y and the z term, but the z term is minus h. And you have your z is equal to minus h. And then we have to take the inner product with the normal and unit normal. The unit normal was 0, 0, minus 1. And that we have to integrate over that part, over that circle. So we have here the integral over 2, and then we have h times ts. That h is again a constant, so you have a constant times the area, and we know already the area, so we get pi a squared. So from all those, the top and the lower part, we have already calculated the flux, and now the wall. So that the flux through the wall. Now we have also again, you have your vector fields, x, y, and then your z term, and then we have to to take the inner product by its normal, and the normal was x, y, and you have for your z term a zero, and you had to divide that by its length. And because that xy was lying on some circle, you had to divide it by a. So here you have the wall, x squared plus y squared is a squared, and your z was between the h and the minus h. That was the wall. And that we have to calculate, that integral we have to calculate over that wall. Now, if we do so, what do we get out of it? So I have that integral over the wall, and now I can write out that inner product. I get x squared plus y squared divided by a times ds, and I see that x squared plus y squared is equal to a squared, and so I have the integral over the wall of a times ds, and then I have to know the surface of a cylinder. Now, the length of it, the radius is a, so you have 2 pi a by its length. And the height, you have h minus minus h, that is 2 times h, and you see that the surface of the cylinder becomes equal to the length of the circle times the height of the cylinder, and I have 4 times h times pi times h. That one here. And so what do I get out of that flux? I have that constant. I have to, a is a constant, so you get a times the surface of the cylinder, and so we have a times just that value we have just calculated here, and that gives us the flux through the wall. So we have done it a little bit easier than Adams is doing. Adams settles, is using those coordinates, but in this case we could do everything without any coordinates, just looking, just realizing that we that we have some constant integrating on some surface, and those surfaces we could easily calculate. Now, the total flux, I will call it, because you have the flux through those walls and all kind. So we have to add those results of those two, the top and below, and of the wall, we have that add together. And what do we get out of it? You get h times pi times a squared. That was, and that 2 times the top, and then the other one plus 4 a squared pi times h. And What do I get out of it? I get 6 times pi times a squared times h. And here I have my flux. Now, this was a little bit easy, so to say, but in most of the time it is not so easy, so be very careful. Yeah, for instance, the other example, we have some time for it, so let me do. And now there is a vector field given. Vector field. The vector field is given by, and I write it down as a vector. I see in the x direction, I see some z. In the y direction, I see a zero. And in the z direction, I see x squared. So here you have your vector field. And then there is also given a surface. And that surface that is given by z is equal to x squared plus y squared. And then you have all kind of terrible bounds for your x and for your y. So you have your x and y are some square in the xy plane. Now that is your surface. Now, as I told you, try to make some sketch of it. Always nice to do. And let me see. We have here the x-axis, z-axis, y-axis, and maybe I can better put that figure a little bit down. So, yes, here, maybe better to do. So here I have the y, and here I have my z-axis, and you know that orientation, I repeat it constantly, that the cross product of EJ has to be k. Now, and then what is given, you are in the xy plane, you have the bound, you have some square. So you have minus 1, 1, 1, minus 1. That is your there you may take your x and your y out of it. And then you see z is x squared, so you have some parabolic surface. And if you are in the, if you take your y equal to 0, you have something like a parabola in the xz plane. Now that one you can rotate around the z-axis, and then you have something like this. But be careful, you have that all kind of those points here, they are on your parabola somewhere. And so you have, and this is not a nice figure, but you have then, if you have the x is one plane, and you have the, then you get something like this. So you have, I think that it looks a little bit like that here. So there you go. Those points at be careful that at the boundary of that rectangle, if the x is 1 and the y is 1, then the z becomes 2 and not 1. And if you are here, you have just 1, so you have something like this. Okay. Now, I have my flux. What do I need? I need the normal on the S. Yeah, the flux. I have to calculate over the, an integral over the S, and then I have to calculate the flux in a product with the unit normal times ds. So I'm asking myself the normal and also the unit normal, but the unit normal is easy, you know, the normal defined by its own length. Now it's the normal itself. You see that your surface, you can rewrite a little bit, and then you have this expression here. So here you have that g x y z is zero, and you know that the gradient of that g stays perpendicular on that surface. So if I take the gradient of this expression here, I get some vector perpendicular to that surface. So if I take the gradient, I become minus 2x minus 2y and equals 1. So yeah, I have here the normal. Okay. And I see that my z component is positive. So I see that my normal is in the positive direction, goes upwards. So normal upwards. So my z component, the z component of the normal is 1, that is positive, so the normal is upwards. And you can say same the so yeah, and so you have a good orientation on your surface. Okay, that we have. Now, that is done easily. Yes, and we can now, in certain sense, we can calculate the function we have to define after to integrate our, over our surface, because we have here the vector field. Now, the vector field that was z0 x squared. And then be aware of the fact later on that that z is given by a function of x and y. So be careful. And then we have our normal minus 2x minus 2y 1. And then times ds. Okay. And yes, that is okay. And we can take for our S term, the ds term, we can take the dx times dy. So this is our the d with a fat s. And so we can take here for our ds, we can take dx dy. Now let we so and so what do we have? we get out of it the integral over the rectangle. Now, there is not the x and the y. I don't know if you can, but the order of integration, I don't know. And then I write out the z was equal to x squared plus y squared times minus 2x. And then I have 0 times minus 2y. And I have plus x squared. And what shall I do? I don't know. Maybe I will do the first y and then the x. I don't know. So be careful. Keep in mind z is x squared plus y squared. Okay. Yes, I think that we have done. No problem. And and so we have yes. Yes, I am now a little bit asking myself, how do I come to this one here? Now, realize yourself that you have the ds term, the d with a fat s, that we can write, that we can calculate it by the gradient of g divided by the third, the derivative of g divided by z, and times dx dy. And so we get here that you have then that is equal to, now that gradient was minus 2x minus 2y 1, and you are dividing it by the derivative, this the j free is the partial derivative of g to the z variable, and that is equal to 1. So you get equal to 1 times dx dy. And so you have your fat s. And that is this term, that is that term here. Okay, now I hope that you can calculate that one without any problem. And if you would do it well, I see that you get, now let I do one step, you get minus 1 plus 1, then you you have to integrate by y. And what do we have then? Minus 2x to the power 3 times y plus 1 over 3 y to the power 3 times minus 2x. And we have an x squared times y. And that between the minus 1 and plus 1. And then we have to integrate once to x. And what do we get out of it? Now fill in minus x to the power 3 minus 2 divided by 3 times x plus x squared, that is the, and then we have to subtract if you fill in minus 1, so we have 2x to the power 3, maybe you get y is minus 1, that's plus, then I have minus 1 over 3 times, so plus 2x and minus x squared dx, and I, what do we have then? All kind of terms, minus 4 times x to the power 3 minus 4 over 3 times x, and we have an 2x squared dx. Now I see this are odd functions. Odd. So if I integrate off from minus 1 to 1, I get 0 out of it. That is easy. And then I have here 2 divided by 3 x to the power 3 between the boundaries plus 1 and minus 1, or minus 1 and plus 1. And so what do we have? 2 divided by 3 minus that one. And it gives us 4 divided by 3. And I think that will be good. Now, so we have just done several examples. And one, yeah, the first example goes really easily because you have constant and constant times a surface. But the other one, the last one, you have really, yeah, to calculate certain things and to be careful with your ds term. That was not going so easy. And okay. No. Try yourself the other examples, I should say. In the next part, I will, next lecture, I will tell you something about the divergence of a vector field and the rotation of a vector field, or if you have the curl, yeah, the rotation curl. I have always learned the rotation, and then I'm always writing rot, but in Adams they use often the curl. Okay. And now let me see what we can tell about it.